Hello and welcome to a new episode of EU Deal After Brexit. Today I receive Alix Renaudin. Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
So we will talk about the refugee protection and consequences of Brexit and asylum. So please tell me, if we go back in time, before Brexit, what was the situation?
So before Brexit, the situation was completely different than before, than today, I mean. There were two systems, so one British national system specific to the UK in national law, which have to respect some international law purposes like the UN Convention on Refugees of 1951, which imposed a non-refoulement principle according which a country cannot send back an asylum seeker to his origin country if his life is threatened or, for example, if he's subject to death penalty there. Other conventions are applicable to national law. We can quote the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, the Convention Against Torture, or in more regional level, the European Convention of Human Rights, which does not contain many purposes on asylum, but many limitations to refoulement. And the other side, there was the EU framework, which was with the CEIS, divided in two phases. But for the UK, it was special, contrary to other member states, because phase one of the CEIS was applicable to the UK, but the second phases, since 2006, wasn't applicable in full. So Dublin III regulation, the famous Dublin III regulation, was applicable, but other part of the system wasn't. So we can say that the global system with internal law and European law was quite insufficient in terms of protection. And in terms of migrations, we saw it in Calais, in the southern of France.
I understand. So let's talk about this humanitarian situation that you just mentioned. Would you say that it has improved since Brexit?
We can't really say that because we say the situation has worsened from the Brexit for many reasons. Due to Brexit, the Dublin III regulation doesn't apply anymore. And this regulation has many bad points, we can say that, but it was at least one good point, which was family reunification, which was simplest under this regulation than under the UK national law, which is more strict. For this condition, for example, it is difficult for children to support their parents to reunion. And there are also a problem in Calais. It is due to the Sandhurst Treaty, according which UK can carry out checks at the French border in the French territory. So when you want to go to London, for example, you take the Eurostar or the shuttle, and you have to check to submit your checks at the French border in the French territory before crossing the channel. So that has consequences on the camps where the population is growing with horrible living conditions. But there were also indirect consequences. It is NGOs, British NGOs, who received many grants from the EU for their action on the ground. So supply food, drinking water, bedding, or clothes, anything important to live. So the EU grants NGOs. In 2017, for example, the NGOs, British NGOs received more than 2,004 million of euros. So now they didn't receive anything.
I understand, but recently the EU and the UK reached an agreement. Does this deal provide solutions to the asylum question?
I don't think so, because yes, that's true. UK and EU reached an agreement on last December. And during the negotiation period, NGOs were concerned of the absence of asylum in negotiations on the top subject. And rightly so, I have to say, because the agreement now doesn't provide really solution to the problem of migration, asylum, or things like that, because the UK left the Dublin III system, but the EU Commission said that it has intention to abolish the Dublin system. And during January, the President Ursula von der Leyen announced that during its discourse for the State of the Union. So We already said that NGOs will lose EU's asylum, migration and integration fund. British NGO was the first beneficiary in the union of these funds.
But if the agreement did not provide any solution, how can these remedies be found? Which legal regime can be applied?
So UK will have to legislate. The only solution is legislate alone, but improving or creating a new legislation, improving existing legislation, but also legislate with its partners, EU, or neighbor countries, France, Belgium. We know that the UK has already many agreements with France on the side, Belgium, or even the EU. And the House of Lords of the Parliament of the UK already expressed its wish to follow the example of Norway, which is not a country in the European Union, it's not a member state, but applies now partially the Dublin regulation system. So some voice called to follow this example. We will see with the new European system on asylum. But we have to say that if the UK is not part anymore of the EU, the UK is still a country for the European continent. So there are migratory flows that impact this continent, and the UK cannot escape from that situation. And also the UK did not withdraw the UN Convention of 1951 on protection of refugees, for example. So the UK will have to legislate taking in account all these elements, so international law, European law, also to be a partner, I mean, of the Union.
So at the end of the day, you think that the humanitarian situation was worsened by Brexit. Don't you think that there is still room for hope?
Yes, that's clear that the future is very uncertain for asylum and humanitarian situation, which is very alarming. And we saw now with the COVID crisis, this is very horrifying, the condition of lives. But let's be optimistic for a while. Brexit is a very good opportunity to change things. It's the first time that a country leaves the European Union. We can be pro or against Brexit, but now what is done is done. So let's take the opportunity to change things in a more human and fair way. For example, in the case of unaccompanied minors, which are now very in a horrifying situation, and the House of Commons, or the lower room of the Parliament of Great Britain, already expressed its wish to improve the British image on this subject, and this is what we wish for the future.
Thank you very much for this perspective. So thank you all for watching this video, and you can find the other videos if you want on the YouTube channel or on the Facebook webpage, Media Lab.